Well, good morning, and can I welcome everyone to this, the sixth meeting of the Public Audit Committee in 2022. The first item for the committee's consideration is to agree to take agenda items 3 and 4 in private. Are we all agreed? We are agreed, thank you. And the main business we've got this morning is consideration of the Auditor General for Scotland's Section 22 report on the 2021-22 audit of the Scottish Government consolidated accounts, along with his briefing on Scotland's public finances, challenges and risks. Can I welcome our witnesses this morning? It's almost exactly a year since we held this session, and this time I'm pleased that all the witnesses are in the room with the committee. So I'm very pleased to welcome the Permanent Secretary, John Paul Marks. Alongside him is Colin Cook, the Director of Economic Development, Alison Cumming, the Director of Budget and Public Spending, and Jackie McAllister, who's the Chief Financial Officer in the Scottish Government. Can I welcome you all to this morning's session? We've got a range of questions that we want to put to you, but before we get to those questions, Permanent Secretary, can I invite you to make a short opening statement?
Convener, thank you. Good morning to the committee, and thank you for your welcome. Thank you to Jackie, Alison and Colin for joining me today. I'd like to start thanking the Auditor General for his report and his assurance on the 21-22 annual accounts. This was another unqualified opinion, but we're very committed to working with Audit Scotland and with the committee to develop further. And I'm sure we'll cover in our session some areas and opportunities for us to do that together. We want to continue to ensure value for money. We want to ensure financial management and good control, and we want to continue to improve good governance, all focused on delivering better outcomes in Scotland. Convener, the operating context, as you know well, remains severely disrupted. The impact of the pandemic, tragic events in Ukraine, and the inflationary shock have all severely impacted on the cost of living, on our budgets, on our economy and our public services. And it's been a challenging year in that context, and those risks are staying with us for the near term. The 21-22 accounts, of course, before us today, just a couple of points from me maybe up front on the transition from those from that 21-22 year into what was a COVID crisis, into our attempt to deliver a COVID recovery. In that year, that response included £5.7 billion of extra support in consequential funding. But of course, that funding did not continue. So into 22-23, we needed to deliver a fiscal consolidation, but continue to deal with the COVID backlogs, and that impact, that risk was then compounded by the shock of further inflation. We've published some more evaluation on COVID spending, particularly around business support, which Colin can allude to, and we'll continue to look to see what more we can do. In terms of balancing the budget, as you know, on Tuesday, Parliament voted the budget through for the next financial year, but through 22-23, we worked really hard to ensure, of course, that we managed those backlogs, brought the budget into balance, and sought to make further progress. And two emergency budget reviews were put in place with £1 billion of in-year adjustments to ensure that that could be done. In terms of our approach, as I said, value for money, good governance, and a focus on delivery remains priority. We have a delivery executive we meet every week, focused on the financial control, on risk, and those prioritised outcomes that we're seeking to deliver. A corporate transformation programme that is really getting going around workforce management and control, which Audit Scotland allude to, around estates and systems transformation. And we are going to need to rebase our capital programme given the shock and impact of inflation. Finally, just a couple of points on progress on outcomes, because I share the committee's desire to see a real focus on performance reporting and improvement in outcomes. We have record high employment in Scotland, the lowest inactivity level across the UK. Child poverty is lower than the UK average. We've got 1,400 fewer children in care compared to 2020 when the promise was launched. And if I look at somewhere like a system like criminal justice, crime is at its lowest levels The prison population is 8% lower than pre-pandemic, and our courts backlog is falling in a sustainable way, and we have further criminal justice reform ahead. We need to accelerate public service reform to look across those systems and drive better outcomes in the months and years ahead. But we have some very important strengths and capabilities in Scotland to build on, and that will be our focus as well. I just want to say thank you to partners across local government, NHS, private voluntary and public sectors for their support this year. It has been challenging, but nonetheless, their partnership, that collaboration is absolutely essential for us to secure and deliver Scotland's national performance framework in the long term. And my final point, if I may, just to pay tribute to the outgoing longest-serving First Minister in Scotland and to thank the First Minister for her significant and enduring contribution to this country. We will be ready to support the new First Minister from March, keeping our feet firmly on the pedals to deliver better outcomes for Scotland. And I'll stop there. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much indeed. I'm going to turn straight to questions and invite Willie Coffey to put a question to you.
Thanks very much, Convener, and good morning, Permanent Secretary and the rest of the team. I wonder if I could invite you to open up some comments, if I may, on the plans to replace the European Union structural funds. As you know, Permanent Secretary, this committee has been keen to try to understand if there is a role for the Scottish Parliament, the Scottish Parliament committees, Audit Scotland and so on, in the replacement and deployment of these funds on behalf of the people of Scotland. So we know the terms shared prosperity, we know about community renewal, and we know about levelling up. Yeah. Could you offer the committee any guidance whatsoever or clarity on arrangements for scrutiny, transparency and audit of these funds in relation to the Scottish Parliament and the work that we do in here?
Yeah, no, thanks, Mr. Coffey. So as you say, the departure from the European Union has changed the way European structural funds work, so that they have been replaced by levelling up funds. I think we've just gone through round two of the levelling up awards, which local government put together their business cases, submit them into DLUHC in the UK government, and then awards are made accordingly. We, Scottish ministers and their officials, obviously would prefer that that money was devolved so that it could be subject to the full scrutiny that this committee would provide, and that it could be coherent with things like the National Strategy for Economic Transformation, which would be the preference for our ministers. But in the absence of that being agreed by the UK government, our intent is to continue to work with local government on their projects that have been successful in getting funded, and to make sure that we're doing everything we can in partnership with them to ensure that they deliver well. So, for example, if there can be some coherence with growth deals in parts of the country, then let's see if we can do that. I was in Glasgow the other day with the chief executive. We'd been out to Glasgow Airport. We'd seen the Advanced Manufacturing Institute. We're then meeting with the chief executive, talking about their levelling up bids, and how we want to, of course, ensure you get maximum bang for your buck. I think we need to reflect carefully on, as those projects get going, how can they be reported in a way that Parliament could, for example, scrutinise the value for money, the effectiveness, are they on track, on time, and to be confident that that fund was working. But Colin's done further work on this. I don't know, Colin, if you want to just add anything more on the scrutiny and audit of levelling up funds, anything else you could add? Thanks.
Sorry, Mr. Coffey. I mean, I saw the exchange with the Auditor General in his evidence around this, and clearly, a UK government fund is subject to UK government auditing arrangements. But our ministers, as the Permanent Secretary has said, have been clear and consistent throughout that they believe, and that future regional economic funding should be devolved and should be delivered with and in partnership with the Scottish Government and UK Government where appropriate, and other tiers of government within Scotland. That's a model that's worked, I think, extremely well for the city and region deals. It's a model that's worked, and I think to everyone's benefit, for the launch of the Green Freeports programme. So I think we have a track record of demonstrating that we can work together. And I know our ministers are in discussions with the Secretary of State for Levelling Up and others about future arrangements.
Thank you for that. But are you seeing any semblance of agreement coming from our colleagues in the UK to recognise this Parliament's role in this process to date? It seems to me, certainly, convener at this committee, that we have tried our best to get some clarity on that, but there remains none. Okay. Are you getting any indication at all that we will have a formal role or otherwise, or will we be looking and glancing from the side as this major spend, this major fund is disbursed and spent throughout Scotland for our communities?
Well, I'm very happy to take away the challenge to go and meet Sue Gray, who's the Permanent Secretary of Leeds on Levelling Up. I met her and the new first Permanent Secretary down there, Sarah Healy, a couple of weeks ago. So there's a new leadership to the department to reinforce the importance of this point, because like you, I want to secure the very best value for money from that funds. I've seen some of the media coverage around how local government feel about the process. We would like the process to be empowered as close to the communities that it serves as possible. And as Colin says, our ministers have been very clear and very consistent that they would prefer it to be devolved. But on your point of, well, how can we now work together? And I think Green Freeports is a good example, as Colin said, where we have, joint governance, joint programme board. Could we not achieve the same on Levelling Up and then provide the committee with more regular updates, including the opportunity to scrutinise projects to be confident that they were indeed delivering what their business cases said, achieving the benefits, and that the funds were being optimised? Like you, I would like to see that. As much transparency as possible. I'm very happy to meet with Sue and or Sarah and report back and write to you.
I think that would be greatly appreciated, convener, if you have that meeting and share with us, if you can, the outcome of that, because we're very keen to pursue this.
I mean, the only other thought I've got is, of course, the committee could invite the Secretary of State for Levelling Up, Michael Gove himself, to come and tell you how it's going.
Thank you. Actually been and maybe coming again.
Great.
Yes,
to the other. He could bring his permanent secretary with him, and
that's an option for us.
That'd be lovely.
Thank you very much for your responses.
Okay. Before we just move off this point, so could you then help us to understand the Green Freeport projects, of which there are two in Scotland?
Yeah.
Are they going to be the subject of scrutiny and audit by the Auditor General for Scotland?
I think I need to double check precisely how we can do that. I would have no problem, from my perspective, enabling that. The way in which I understand the governance is that it's a UK programme for which the Scotland free port elements, the two ports that we have devolved funding for or are getting funding for, the 52 million, we've got very good joint working to deliver that. If there is a mechanism that we can enable for Audit Scotland to be able to audit the 52 million for the two projects in Scotland, I would be totally comfortable with that. But I just need to understand that the governance around that programme and the UK position to understand whether that's problematic at all. But Colin, anything else?
No, I mean, just to reiterate from a sort of official working level, we've collaborated really effectively with UK government colleagues throughout in terms of preparing the prospectus, in terms of assessing the bids, in terms of the way in which we communicate, and we're starting to plan and work on the rollout of Green Freeports. We've done that together, we've shared responsibility, we've been open, and therefore I think it's a very strong position. As the Permanent Secretary said, I think we do need to just check the precise nature of the auditing arrangements, given the relative contributions that the different governments are making to this programme in Scotland. But I'm sure we can do that and carry on in that spirit.
Okay, thank you. Because for us, it's not just about the £50 million of money. It's also about the governance arrangements, the outcomes. It's about the whole way that that operates and whether there is any displacement effect, for example. Yeah. I'm going to bring in the deputy convener who's got some questions to put to you.
Thank you. Good morning.
Good morning.
Can you confirm the amount that was transferred to the Scotland Reserve at the end of 21-22?
Jackie, could you just check that for me?
Of course, yeah. So in the provisional outturn statement, which was presented to Parliament in the summer of 22, we transferred £650 million in total, and that was a combination of resource, capital and financial transaction funding through the Scotland Reserve. The final outturn for 21-22 is still to be reported to Parliament. We hope that that will be imminent, but we have to wait for all of the bodies that feed in to the Scotland Reserve to complete their 21-22 accounts and audit process, and that are still outstanding.
Okay, thank you. Will that money be used to support the 22-23 budget plans?
Indeed, and the 22-23 budget itself set out and included quite a significant proportion of the Scotland Reserve within its budget statement, and the remainder, the additional carry forward, has all been deployed and utilised within 22-23.
What plans did the Scottish Government have to increase transparency over the Scotland Reserve?
Thank you. So we are very keen to continue to explore with Audit Scotland how we can increase transparency. We do think that there is a good degree of transparency around the Scotland Reserve. As I mentioned, we periodically report to Parliament the provisional outturn, the final outturn, the fiscal framework outturn. It includes a full reconciliation of the reserve, the funding that goes in and how that's drawn down. Within the consolidated accounts, we also refer and acknowledge in the performance report at the front of the accounts the difference between the consolidated accounts and the Scotland Reserve, and they're not quite the same thing. But we can look at how we disclose that information, how we can be more transparent in that narrative, the narrative that's already there. And we can also look at the information that we provide in the final outturn report to Parliament to again see how we can increase that transparency. I'm aware that routinely this committee doesn't see that report, and again, that's something that I'm sure we could look at providing.
Yeah, that would be excellent. Can I ask who in the Scottish Government agrees with ministers any funding for announcements? So what, if the Scottish Government or the ministers are announcing money for a specific project, how does that come about? Who agrees that the amount is there and it's available?
Yeah, so we have a very, compared to what I've seen before, we have a very comprehensive accountable officer template process for all spending decisions. So it would start within the portfolio. So if a portfolio minister and the cabinet secretary wants to make an announcement, then that will go through an accountable officer process to assure, for example, that it's proper, regular, that we have the legislation in place, that we have the budget and all the rest of it. And then, so it's for that Director General, that accountable officer with their minister. If there was a level of contention with regards to that, for example, it might not be affordable within their existing budget, then those templates are signed off by Jackie and myself, so that, and then ultimately the Deputy First Minister is Finance Secretary as well. And that control process through the last financial year has been really critical for us because of the level of risk. And Audit Scotland, very fair in their challenge on this last November in their report, around saying the level of risk to whether the balance was going to balance, whether the budget was going to balance, was significant. And that was the case. So being in control of the decisions and the spending is something we've put a lot of effort into in the last year.
I'm kind of thinking specifically about the money that was offered for the teachers. So £156 million offer to the teachers. It was broken down by £30 million for this financial year and £123 million for the financial year 2023-24. And it's coming from the education and skills budget. Yeah. But at committee, Shirley Ann Somerville had stated that she was still working through the details of where exactly the money's coming from. So would that not be set in stone before we went and made the announcement? Because obviously that's got huge implications for education and skills.
So there's two different budgets in play there in terms of that announcement. The 30-odd million that you refer to is in the 22-23 accounts for which we had a provision and agreement through our AO process, agreed with the Cabinet Secretary, the Deputy First Minister, and that is will be in the next set of annual report and accounts. What the Cabinet Secretary is then alluding to was the second part of that pay offer, which was for 23-24. But of course, by the point at which that was being announced, which is a future spending commitment, the budget was only passed by Parliament on Tuesday. So it's a commitment to a future liability on pay, which is affordable within the education budget, but it will be precisely for the Cabinet Secretary to balance her 23-24 budget based on the allocation that Parliament voted on Tuesday.
So when will it become transparent to us where the cuts have came in education and skills?
Well, it will become clear either through the scrutiny that the Committee on Education will provide or through future annual report and accounts and in future financial reporting. But to be clear, we have budgeted for those pay deals, so we are not wanting to have consequential cuts to fund them. We are trying to achieve a balanced budget for next year. That is not easy, as I said, given the context and the fiscal position. And obviously, we have quite a lot of dependency on what will come out of the March UK budget in terms of any consequentials or not for the block grant. So there is uncertainty, but that pay deal that was announced by ministers is funded in our budget. I don't know if Jackie or Alison want to add anything more to that, but thanks.
Just on the transparency point, so the autumn budget revision and the spring budget revision will give full transparency on all budget movements that are agreed and actioned through the year.
Yeah, thank you.
Okay. Again, looking at the track record and quite significant underspends, most recently the £2 billion underspend, what processes are in place or should be in place to make sure that us as parliamentarians can actually scrutinise that and see what money has not been spent and why it's not been spent?
Yeah. Well, you're right to draw out the scale of underspend in the 21-22 accounts. And we were just looking earlier at some of the big drivers of that. You know, the student loans revaluation for the resource underspend for education was 600 million of that change. The business support, which, as I said, was very much driven by COVID consequentials, which were then discontinued, was another 180 million, and then further underspends across heat and buildings of 250 million due to pandemic impacts and demand factors. I think I would say with a high degree of confidence that we are not going to see that underspend in our 22-23 accounts. Unless my chief finance officer is, and I don't understand each other. But, you know, as I say, we meet every week to go through our budget to squeeze every inch out of it. And the process of the last year has been very, very challenging to balance the budget. And we have, quite rightly, as you'd expect, sought to protect our cost of living package, so expanding the Scottish Child Payment, increasing its eligibility, trying to do everything we can to mitigate the impact of the inflationary shock on households. And we created in year more than £700 million of additional spending to afford public sector pay awards for 22-23. And that, in part, has enabled us to avoid, for example, to date, industrial action across our health service. So you're right, there are a set of factors that drove underspend in 21-22. Many of those factors, like inflation in Ukraine, persisted, but I do not expect to see those underspends repeated. But Jackie, do you want to just say anything more on that?
Yeah, if I may. I mean, I think one of the first points is that the £2 billion underspend doesn't represent a £2 billion underspend in spending power for the Scottish Government, or indeed the Scottish Government and the bodies that are part of the consolidated accounts. Indeed, almost half of that underspend was non-cash valuation, technical accounting adjustments. And I think that's quite important to note, that the accounts are a reflection not just of the spending year, but of the assets and the liabilities and the provisions, and we have to revalue those each and every year, and we need budget to do that. And quite a bit of the underspend, as Permanent Secretary alluded to, was some very late changes in some of the index-linked assumptions that were driving a lot of the valuations for our provisions and our liabilities. So it was after we had the spring budget revision and the last opportunity to change our budget assumptions in 21-22. As we spoke about, the spending power is what's reflected through the Scotland Reserve, and the provisional outturn for that was £650 million. We will be reporting a final outturn. We expect that to be closer to £700 million, but that is the spending power that we carried forward. We carried forward into the year. We included in the budget for 22-23 more than half of that, and the rest, as I say, has been fully deployed within 22-23.
OK, and final question. What plans do you have to be more proactive in publishing comprehensive COVID-19 spending information, and if this will make clear links between budgets, funding announcements and actual spending?
Yeah. I'll ask Colin just to say a bit more about that, because the committee gave us that fair challenge last year, and we worked to publish a pretty significant evaluation, for example, on business support grants and funding with regards to COVID spending. And if there are particular additional areas, like on the vaccination programme or PPE or whatever, then obviously we're happy to take that away. I think the final point for me is obviously there is two COVID inquiries underway, the UK one, the Scottish one, and it will cover a range of scope, but of course we will also ensure that we submit all the evidence around the support that we try to put in place to mitigate some of the impacts. But Colin, maybe say a bit more on the business support evaluation that we've published.
Thank you, Permanent Secretary. Yes, I mean, we published that back in June 22, and that's an evaluation of the outputs and the indicative outcomes of schemes up until summer 21. And we're continuing to work on that with our colleagues in the analytical service to refine and update that. So it looks at things like, it looks at spend, an investment of around about £3 billion. And it looks at things like rates relief and schemes administered by local authorities and schemes administered by our enterprise agency. And it looks at it first in terms of the emergency response that we put together between April 2020 and October 2020. And then when we introduced the strategic business framework beyond that, October 2020 onwards, it looks at that element as well. So we will update that. And I think there's some really detailed information in there. And it is published on the Scottish Government's website.
Thank you.
Thanks. We've got quite a lot of questions to get through, and I'm anxious to press the accelerator just a little bit and invite Willie Coffey to come in. Willie.
Thanks again, Convener. I'll just be as brief as I can with these questions. It was really to invite you to say something about the public sector consolidated accounts and the plans to produce those. Firstly, if you might explain, what are they? What's the difference between those and the consolidated accounts that we're looking at just now? I know there's an interface with the UK's whole of government account, and there's plans to produce this. So briefly, Permanent Secretary, could you just explain for the benefit of the committee what that account is?
Yeah, well, no, I mean, I think you said it exactly right. So these accounts brings together everything that the Scottish Government funds and audits in terms of things, NHS, Social Security, Justice, etc. Stage one of whole public sector accounts we've made good progress on, thanks to the team shared with Audit Scotland, and that includes accounts with regards to the Parliament, executive public bodies, and Audit Scotland themselves, so that that will show a broader scope of the spending, so you can see the whole. The next stage, as you say, the challenge is the delays and the recovery plan that the Treasury have for whole government accounts for the whole of the UK, which we need to draw on for the data for particularly local governments. So Jackie and the team will work with the Treasury on that and with Audit Scotland for the next stage of that.
Have we a revised timetable for the final production of, well, let's call it the draft? Do we know what the timetable is? Well,
as I understand it, they are saying so for 21-22 whole government accounts from the UK, it's going to be almost 2-3 years' time from now. So it is going to unfortunately have a fair lag in it, which is quite frustrating in terms of utility. But Jackie, just say a bit more.
Yeah, absolutely. And to be clear, I think when we spoke last year at committee, we articulated a staged approach to the public sector accounts. And as Permanent Secretary has stated, we've completed the stage one for 2021 and we shared the draft with Audit Scotland and we are lined up to do the same for 21-22. The issue becomes moving on to stage two and bringing in, as Permanent Secretary alluded, the other bodies such as local government. We are relying on the whole of government accounts process from the UK perspective, and there is a recovery timeline in place for whole of government accounts, and that will drive when that information is available for us. But stage one, as I say, it has been completed for 2021. It will be completed for 21-22. Again, that's something that, you know, the committee may be interested in having sight of. We'd be very happy to share that.
Yep. And lastly, has the IT issues at HM Treasury been resolved? And do we have enough resource to put this all together in a timely fashion?
So they have been resolved. The issue is there's now the catch-up, if you like, and that's the timeline that Treasury have set out. We have the resources to approach this in the way that we presented, which is relying on the whole of government accounts process. Otherwise, we would need to significantly, you know, we need to consider what the implications and the resources would be to do otherwise, and that's something we'd want to engage with Audit Scotland on.
Thanks very much for that. Happy to hand back to.
Thank you very much. I mean, the reason why this is important is not least because, as we reminded you last year when you had just arrived into your post, Permanent Secretary, that this has been ongoing since 2016, that we were promised whole public sector consolidated accounts back in 2016. And here we are in 2023 and we're at stage one. So the Auditor General in his report, the report we're discussing this morning, says this. He says, the continuing absence of a devolved public sector consolidated account means it is difficult to assess the overall health of Scotland's public finances at a time of greatest need. So there's quite an urgency. This is quite imperative. And I wonder if you would reflect on that after today's session, because I don't sense the urgency which we think is necessary to be applied to this so that we can get a full picture of what we owe and what we owe, which is the expression the Auditor General has used. Mm-hmm. Can I move on to another area? And that's around capital borrowing. Back in, I think it was 2018, the then Chief Financial Officer, that wasn't you, Jackie McAllister, it was one of your predecessors, but back then, the Chief Financial Officer was able to provide a list of assets to this committee, those assets that attracted capital borrowing. Is the Scottish Government able to provide a list of underlying assets for which it uses capital borrowing for today?
Do you want to take that?
Yeah, I'm very happy.
Given your predecessor has set it up.
Indeed. So thank you, Convener. I mean, I think the first thing to say is that we do not set our capital borrowing policy on the basis of specific capital projects or programmes. We do so on the basis of the capital portfolio as a whole, and that's set out in the medium-term financial strategy document, which, of course, is publicly available. That said, I think there is significant amount of transparency around the capital portfolio and the programmes that sit within that, and there's regular reporting to Parliament on those. I think it's a 6-monthly reporting of all the infrastructure and capital programmes that the Scottish Government is funding. There are very good reasons why we set our capital borrowing policy at a capital portfolio rather than an individual programme. There's lots of value for money reasons why we do that. But it's also, borrowing is only, I mean, it's less than 10% of our overall capital funding. And the capital funding is predominantly set by UK government and the Barnett funding, which of course can vary in year. So it's really important that we have that flexibility in year as we move through the year to accelerate or decelerate our capital borrowing plans, depending on the funding factors, also the spending. And I think even if we look just at the last few years and the level of slippage that there's been in capital programmes, not just in the Scottish Government, but in UK Government and other organisations, because of the pandemic, because of supply chain issues, then had we taken an approach to borrow on a programme or a project basis, we could have borrowed too much too soon and effectively lost that flexibility as we've moved through the year. So this is something that we think is the best value, and it gives us the most flexibility to manage within effectively the fiscal framework that we're operating within.
Can you tell us a little bit more about the timescales that you work to for your borrowing? I mean, I think the fiscal framework has got a default position of 10 years, hasn't it? But I mean, do you look at shorter periods than that, longer periods than that? How do you come to settle on that?
Absolutely. I mean, there's a significant amount of modelling that goes in when we take the decisions around both the value of the capital borrowing and the tenure. And that will be determined by a number of different factors, including the cost of borrowing. And indeed, we've seen a shift in the cost of borrowing, and that has influenced our decision making and our borrowing strategies. But that is determined, you know, we will do that on an ongoing basis, and all of that information will feed into the advice towards the end of the year on the final amount of borrowing and the tenure. And I suppose that just reinforces the point about not locking in borrowing to particular programmes and assets, because we need to keep taking that portfolio approach to deliver the best value for the Scottish funds.
The fiscal framework, I think I'm just getting this right. And so for resource borrowing, the tenure is maximum 5 years for us to pay that back. And so as Jackie says, for us to be using borrowing for a particular project or announcement, as we were talking about earlier, you know, that from my perspective is suboptimal. You know, so I'm expecting an announcement, a project to be funded and to have a budget line, so I can be confident it's deliverable. If it's depending on borrowing for it, then from my perspective, that is increasing costs, because obviously we've got to pay the borrowing back. So it's a flexibility in year for short term, depending on movements, some of which we either can't forecast or happen to us because of external factors. But your point on tenure, for resource, 5 years, and then capital, I think, repaid within 15 years. So we have a long, 10 to 15 years. So we have a longer window on the capital borrowing if we need to.
Okay, thanks. I mean, I think the watchword for us here is about transparency.
Yeah.
And I think whether we're looking at the reserve balance, which is not disclosed in the accounts, whether we're looking at the failure to produce significant progress on the whole of public sector consolidated accounts, or whether it's the extent to which there is transparency about capital borrowing. I think the view of the committee and of the Auditor General is that much more could be done to improve the levels of transparency. And again, I hope that you will perhaps reflect on that.
And just to reiterate, we're really happy to meet with Audit Scotland to think particularly on this point around borrowing. You know, what more can we do to sort of improve that understanding of how we're utilising it and transparency on the rationale. And I think also later this year, in the terms of the medium-term fiscal strategy, Alison will seek to set out again, the medium-term plan and be as transparent as we possibly can on capital allocations to projects, so you can be very clear what's funded, over what years, to deliver what benefits.
Thanks. Because in the end, this is about accountability to Parliament.
Yeah, no, it is. And to be honest, that transparency and scrutiny helps drive value for money. And that's what I want to see. Yeah.
Good. OK, I'm going to ask Craig Hoy to put some questions to you. Craig.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Mr. Morris. If I just ask you to reflect on COVID-19 support payments and the issue of fraud, obviously 21-22, I believe the government allocated £5.3 billion in funding to COVID response activities. The estimate, I think, that we were working was probably fraud and error equated to 1-2% off that. Are you in a position to say to the committee how much has been recovered through fraud and how much has been recovered through payments made in error during that financial year?
I'll ask Colin to say a bit more, but your assumption is the same as mine. So, as you say, an estimate of 1-2% of fraud and error, which was, I think, 16 to 32 million range of loss. And one of the reasons we were assured that number was low was because the way in which those support mechanisms were delivered via local government using existing systems and existing data sets and through their processes and other public agencies as well as local government. But on recovery, Colin, I don't know if there's anything more we can say today. If we can't, then very happy that we also followed up. But yeah, thanks.
Well, I mean, the figure quoted in the accounts in relation to business support was £504,000 recovered as of July 2022, and that's the most recent figure we've published. I mean, we're continuing to work with our delivery partners in local government and others to monitor this, alongside work with Audit Scotland and others to really get underneath the skin. But that's as far as we've got. But we're continuing to look at this, and I think that is a figure that it's a figure that's in the public domain, and we'll continue to look at it.
And what more can you or other agencies do to accelerate that recovery? And what are your plans to provide regular updates so that we can get assurance on what is a relatively small percentage, but of a very, very large sum? So obviously we're talking about a significant amount of public money here. So what plans have you got both to speed the recovery and to ensure there's greater transparency on the numbers?
Well, as I say, we continue to work on this with partners. We're continuing, and we are always committed to transparency. So when those numbers become available, when we've verified them, we will publish them in due course within our accounts or out with that process if it's a more acceptable way of doing it. So we will continue to do that.
And this will be a bit of a guesstimate. Do you have an idea of what percentage you think you might be able to recover?
I'm afraid I can't speculate on that.
Okay. I'm now going to invite Colin Beattie to put some questions to you. Colin.
Thank you, Convener. I guess one of the key issues in connection with the budget is sustainability, especially in the present climate. And yet the Scottish budget is really only allocated annually. We don't know for sure how much money we're going to get until well into the budgeting process. I mean, witness the fact that just earlier this week, the Finance Secretary was able to announce some small additional money coming from UK. Now, if we're looking at sustainability in the short and medium term, how do you factor that in? How do you actually have a sustainable budget with reliable allocations in support of those areas that need to be supported when you don't know how much money you're actually going to have and your entire allocations might be turned upside down?
Yeah. Well, it's a great question, Mr. Beattie, and it is sadly the underlying challenge that we face. And I've obviously just been doing this for a year now, and I find it pretty deeply uncomfortable that those are the facts. But the bottom line is, as you say, and the Auditor General and I were reflecting on it the other day, that, you know, for an organisation, for a nation that is running a £50 billion budget, the flexibilities that we have to manage shocks and or, as you say, adjust for those in-year changes are limited, but we try and obviously then maximise them to the best of our ability. Jackie and the team do a brilliant job to try and monitor all the outturns as carefully as we can, so we know what we're spending, and work very closely with Her Majesty's Treasury to give us a sense of what might be coming in the future. But as we've seen over the last year, that can change pretty quickly depending on events in Whitehall. So we need to be able to respond to that and have those relationships in place and understand UK government choices. As you say, the Deputy First Minister was able to do something with some additional supplementary income that we received for resource, which is welcome. And Alison might just say a bit more about that and Budget 23-24. But we are in the process of a fiscal framework review. We would like to improve the flexibilities available to the Scottish Government and to this Parliament to be able to manage those risks, as you say, so that we could hedge for uncertainty more and smooth those disruptions. And as an accountable officer, that would clearly make life feel a little bit more stable and in control. In the end, we have a level of risk that we take. And as I say, last year, we ended up finding ourselves with a significant risk in the summer as a function of the impact of the inflationary shock and war in Ukraine, which is what led us to two emergency budget in-year reviews and £1 billion of adjustments. But those adjustments all disrupt programmes and change what were agreed plans, and that is not optimal. And clearly, I would prefer us not to have to operate in that sort of short-term way. So I think getting more flexibility would be helpful. But Alison, anything else you'd like to add to that?
Thank you. I would return to your point about planning and how we seek to mitigate against these risks. The introduction of the medium-term financial strategy, which we publish annually, is key here in helping us identify those fiscal sustainability risks and identifying the tools and strategies that we can put in place to manage those. The government published the resource spending review in May last year, and that set out our best planning assumptions at the time around the financial envelopes down to portfolio level and below, but also set out the actions and the work streams that we're putting in place to support improved sustainability over the medium term. And we might come on to talk about some of those. The other element I would point to is that we have a very helpful reference point through the Scottish Fiscal Commission's forecasting work. It's forecasts that are published alongside the budget, and there'll be refreshed forecasts also alongside the medium-term financial strategy, look at the economic outlook, and they look forward to their best forecast projections, looking at the OBR estimates for UK spending as to what the Scottish Government's expanded spending envelopes could be. So we respond to these in terms of how we approach both the medium-term financial strategy but also the annual budget processes, and that can feed into the in-year management strategy also.
Now, the Permanent Secretary mentioned they were engaged with the Treasury in discussions. Do they understand the risks that the Scottish Government has to take in its budget and the instability it creates? And that instability isn't just at national government level, it also permeates right down to local level, because local government can't be sure what they're going to get. I talked to many community groups that ask, you know, just please give us 3 years funding, you know, tell us what we're going to get for the next 3 years. And it can't happen because local government doesn't necessarily know what it's going to have. National government doesn't necessarily know what it has. That isn't really good government. It's not a good process. So what is the Treasury saying? Do they have a solution to this? Do they have something that might support the government better, our government better?
Yeah, and you know, I say this as a former Treasury official, so I kind of, you know, I have to be fair to my colleagues. That, I mean, to be they absolutely understand the fiscal framework. I suspect the teams are meeting, what, every week, all the time. Certainly, I am talking to my colleagues in Whitehall every week, and we are seeking to optimise the existing devolution settlement as best we can to deliver the very best outcomes, serve our ministers, respective ministers. I agree with you, there is an opportunity in the fiscal framework review to improve the flexibility that is inbuilt to it. So there is some flexibility, of course, and we do have a certain level of certainty around what our expectations, for example, of what we will plan for next year on tax revenues, around social security outturns. But particularly as we devolve more social security into Scotland, because it sits in our resource budget, whereas in Whitehall it sits in an annual managed expenditure, where there are in-year fluctuations because unemployment is higher or more people claim a disability benefit, that is managed flexibly. For us, that is managed through an in-year fixed budget. So we have to then make end-year adjustment provisions for changes in social security spending, and we have to make sure that we are being really precise in understanding, you know, take-up and eligibility, and quite right too, because we want to be in financial control of social security spending. But nonetheless, it adds risk. So I think there's an opportunity in the fiscal framework review. I think Treasury colleagues totally understand how it works, and I hope we'll see ministers working together in the year ahead to see what more we can do to improve that flexibility. But Alison, I don't know, anything else you want to add to that?
No, that was very comprehensive. I don't think there's anything further we can say at present about the fiscal framework review, but we would certainly hope that we can address some of the concerns that we have around those flexibilities and going into those discussions with the experience of having operated the fiscal framework. Yeah. For the last few years.
Well, maybe we can look at one or two of the issues around sustainability going forward. You published a briefing paper on Scottish Government's financial sustainability for 2022-23. How in the light of that is the sustainability being managed? How has it developed? How has it moved on to be better managed than it has been in the past? We recognise there's all sorts of issues come in. I mean, for example, the Scottish rate of income tax, the estimates of how much we're getting from that have sometimes been fairly dramatically incorrect. So how are you managing going forward the sustainability position?
So Alison will say a bit more as well on this, but I think you know, we have a director in our Exchequer who is focused on a fiscal sustainability project, and we're working with Audit Scotland on that, and very happy to keep doing so. When I stand back and think about the long-term trends for Scotland, it's very important, you know, with the Scottish Fiscal Commission and, you know, the universities and others, we understand the underlying drivers of our economy, so labour market participation rates, an ageing population, what's our underlying growth rates, so that we're clear on what our forecast long-term tax revenues are, given decisions made. And of course, ministers made decisions in the latest budget to increase our taxation, which gives us additional revenues in the short and in the long term. But earnings assumptions, for example, were very critical in the latest Scottish Fiscal Commission report, and very material in terms of the envelope for the 23-24 budget. And so choices that we're making around pay and fair work and the performance of our labour market, these are all critical factors that are informing our understanding of Scotland's long term. We then have to understand those assumptions, work with the Scottish Fiscal Commission, with Audit Scotland, make sure that they're prudent, and then plan multi-year. And I think our medium-term fiscal strategy would seek to do exactly that, given our understanding of what our statutory commitments are, what our pay deals that are consolidated are, and therefore what our long-term resource baseline is expected to be. That then, of course, leaves headroom for discretion, where ministers then have choices. And the more that is baseline consolidated and statutory, the less that is left for further choices, subject to, of course, how big the envelope is. I mentioned in my opening remarks about needing to rebase our capital programme, given the impact of inflation. That's true for every government around the world, given double-digit inflationary shocks, which were not forecast in business cases before last year. And that, again, will be critical to long-term sustainability and understanding in this country. What projects can we deliver in a sustainable way in the future, given the envelope available to us? But, Alison, anything else to add?
Thank you. On tax performance, we'd also just flag that the fiscal framework does create those incentives for Scotland to improve its relative economic performance, and that's the through the elements that the Permanent Secretary outlined about driving earnings growth, more higher value jobs, to grow our tax base and our tax revenues is certainly a significant factor for us here. And the National Strategy for Economic Transformation has programmes within it that are designed to do that. So in terms of how we look at fiscal sustainability, it is very much in these two through these two lenses of the taxes we can raise and how we can work the fiscal framework to our advantage in terms of how we improve that underlying economic performance to improve the net revenue position, and also how we can drive that maximum value from our spend, which does rely in large part on prioritisation. But I suppose three elements that I would draw attention to that we're looking at and being very thoughtful about how we get that balance, and recognising that the fiscal outlook is challenging for the remainder of the resource spending review periods and beyond, and recognising that we need to drive out some of the expenditure that's currently in the system in order to manage those pressures that lie ahead. The Deputy First Minister reiterated in his Stage 3 debate speeches that the government will bring forward a pay strategy for 23-24. Before the end of this financial year, and there's obviously very careful considerations to weigh up there with the cost of living pressures facing public sector workforce, but against the inflationary pressures and the funding challenges within our overall budgetary envelopes. The resource spending review, I would just flag some of the work streams there, a focus on digitalisation and improved digital methods of delivering public services to improve efficiency as well as the user experience for citizens. We've got the Single Scottish Estate programme, looking at how we are using the public sector estate across the piece. We have our public procurement strategy for Scotland due in April, which will look about how we are maximising value through procurement across the public sector. And that leads into the final point on public service reform. And that is absolutely imperative to securing a fiscally sustainable future. That is partly about how we use resources more efficiently, but also recognising that if services are person-centred and preventative, we can be reducing the failure demand and saving money on some of the interventions that we make in other parts of the system.
The mention was made of headroom, and from that I interpret keeping a margin within which, if there are fluctuations in funding and so on, we can remain within our balanced budget, which as a government we have to do. To what extent is the amount of that headroom, how much will of that have a margin is impacted by sustainability issues in relation to allocations of funding from the UK government? In other words, are we sitting here saying, okay, we've got this budget, but we're going to have to keep 5% or whatever, just in case there's a change in the course of the year, and only at the end of the year then can we allocate that funding because we know we're keeping it. I mean, are we in that sort of situation?
I don't think we are, but Jackie will just make sure I get this right. I think we are taking quite a risk-based approach. So it's not that we're holding money back because it might be taken off us. It's that, if anything, we're taking a level of risk for which we're planning something might change. And, you know, over the years, and obviously the 21-22 accounts that are here, there was significant in-year consequential funding. And as you said, Mr. Beattie, particularly when it arrives late in the financial year, it feels like a windfall, but it's quite difficult to actually use it in an optimal way. Now, that's not quite fair, for example, for local government, where we're able to, as you say, as the Deputy First Minister could, you know, we're able to allocate money and people can use reserves to smooth it over longer, over multi-years, and local government can do that. But no, we program in a level of risk. We don't hold money back to mitigate that risk. And so that's the bit that creates a level of anxiety in terms of managing that risk down through the year. But Jackie, do you want to say anything more on that?
Absolutely right, Permanent Secretary. I think if you look over the recent history, there has been a trend in terms of in-year funding changes, and particularly during the pandemic, it was exceptionally large. But there have been increases in funding, particularly on resource in recent years. We certainly don't anticipate those, but we work really closely with Treasury colleagues throughout the year to understand what's happening in the UK government space, because of course our funding is driven by UK government spending, generally speaking. I think the Deputy First Minister has been quite transparent through the emergency budget review and indeed through the various different stages of the 23-24 budget process that the Scottish Government has been managing down a pressure. And the Permanent Secretary spoke earlier of the drivers of some of that pressure, the cost of the pay deals and the inflationary increases. So we are we have a number of levers, if you like, that we would use in year, including the emergency budget review, but looking at other areas of our spend where we would go to if there were changes in our funding arrangements. Indeed, this year alone, we received negative capital consequentials from Treasury, not insignificant amount of money. So we had to look at our capital plans, we had to look at our borrowing plans, coming back to the point that we spoke about earlier, and we have to use all of these flexibilities to manage these adjustments, which can go up or down.
Coming back to headroom, typically, what sort of percentage of the Scottish budget would be held back or fall under that term headroom that you're keeping there as a margin?
I think when I used the word headroom, what I was really trying to mean is when we're talking about long-term sustainability and you're doing the forecasts, we can start with, well, what are the statutory commitments or liabilities which are baked in? And that gives you your statutory baseline. So that would be things like pay and pensions, for example. Now, you can reduce those things, but not easily in the short term. It's more about controlling rather than reducing the statutory baseline, clearly. And we have a commitment to no compulsory redundancies, for example, and all the rest of it. So we're able to forecast the statutory baseline, and then we're able to see what the headroom is that remains. And that is the pot, if you like, for which there are choices. And that then is a choice that is allocative, subject to prioritisation, and is what the budget process is all about. And ministers and parliament and stakeholders and partners will all have their view. And, you know, that is the choices then that the ministers are offered advice on. But clearly, the more that is statutory and baselined and consolidated, the less that is available to put into other programmes, as Alison was alluding to, where we want to address the underlying causes of fiscal sustainability. We want to drive down, for example, levels of inactivity, support more people into work, reduce health inequality, reduce child poverty, reduce homelessness. These are all things we want to do, but they are all programmes that have cost. So there is only a limit of how much we can invest in them, and that is the headroom over and above what is statutory liability.
You talked about risk and that the government accepts and manages risk when setting the budget. So clearly the risk is you might overspend, you might get a reduction in year of your funding, all those sort of things. So is there a risk matrix as such? Who makes that decision on whether the risk is acceptable?
In terms of the budget, ultimately the decision is made by the Deputy First Minister with Cabinet. So the Deputy First Minister will agree collective agreement on the budget package, obviously with the First Minister and then with Cabinet. And I will provide assurance on that based on advice from my budget team and Chief Finance Officer. And the Deputy First Minister will seek that assurance as well. I also look to that from my accountable officers for each of the portfolios. So, for example, in the recent weeks, I have met with accountable officers for net zero, across transport, communities, health, education and justice, to review their 23-24 budget allocations, review their programmes, review what are statutory commitments, and then review the choices that remain for them to balance their budgets. And it is, of course, ultimately for them and their ministers to provide advice and to deliver those balanced budgets if they can. And that is what we seek to achieve in terms of collective accountability. And of course, Parliament votes on that budget accordingly. But if I take last year, where the planning assumption was public sector pay of 2% in the resource spending review, and we're clearly some way off that now, given inflation and given quite reasonable ministerial choices that we've made to seek to deliver fair but also affordable pay awards, protect sustainable public services and try and prevent the disruption of industrial action. And we want to, of course, do that. And we work very closely with our trade unions and our ministers are in constant dialogue to try and secure that. But that was an in-year adjustment due to an external shock, which was a significant change in under plans. And that required us to then deliver the two emergency budget reviews and the £1 billion in-year adjustment. But Jackie, anything more on that around
accountability? Just around managing risk. So to give you some assurance, I mean, this is a risk that's actively managed in year, through the year, with the executive team. We agree with Cabinet at the start of the year the flight path, for want of a better expression, the milestones within the year. And a really good example of that active management is the emergency budget review, because it was clear that we were not on track to meet that particular milestone, therefore had to take corrective action and identify further savings. So it is something that is very actively managed through the year. As Permanent Secretary has said, you know, there's a significant portfolio of spending. A lot of those programmes can be demand-led. So we do expect volatility when we set the budgets at the start of the year and we provide forecasts through the year. We do expect them to shift. Some will go up, some will go down. Part of the active in-year management is understanding those movements, calibrating the risk and taking the decisions at the right time through the year. And as I say, I think 22-23 is a good example of that.
Thank you very much indeed. We've got two or three more critical areas that we do want to cover before the session ends. One of those is public sector reform, which I think Alison Cumming alluded to a few minutes ago. So we know that following the resource spending review last May, June time, there was an outline of public sector reform priorities set forward by the government, which spoke about new approaches to public services, such as the development of the National Care Service, reforms to public sector capacity and pay, efficiencies for the public sector, including further use of shared services, and efficiencies in the management of the public sector estate, and reforms to Scotland's 129 public bodies. So I guess the question we've got is, what progress have you made with that agenda?
Yeah. No, well, as Alison alluded to earlier, this will be critical to long-term fiscal sustainability in Scotland, but there are also a lot of opportunities here around also improving outcomes and delivering better value for money for the taxpayer. So if I just take a state as one of the examples, convener, that you referenced across the Scottish Government, you know, we now have put in place an estates programme. We have a number of buildings where leases are coming to an end, which we will be leaving in the next couple of years as we right-size our footprint. If I take workforce, overall, if I look at permanent and contracted resource across the Scottish Government, we are forecast overall to be marginally smaller than we were this time when I appeared before you this time last year. We've put in place significant workforce controls across the Scottish Government to seek to ultimately control pay bill by controlling headcount. So across the state, across workforce, we want to make sure we are living the public sector reform principles that were in the resource spending review, and that our sponsor teams are then working with our sponsor bodies to enable them to do the same. And obviously their budget allocations are, I'm afraid, challenging because of the fiscal sustainability point that we made. And I mean, Colin, for example, can say a bit about some of the examples of the public bodies he's working with, where we're seeking to do more online, deliver digital services, enable that channel shift so citizens can get a better service at less cost, control workforce, right-size estate, and then, as Alison alluded to, drive better value for money out of, for example, public sector procurements. If I could just take an example, though, of, I was looking at this the other day with the new Crown Agent with regards our end-to-end criminal justice system. You know, Police Scotland have obviously in the last few years gone through a significant transformation as they came together as a single national service, driving out efficiency. And as I say, we have seen good delivery in terms of what the Chief Constable has been able to achieve in terms of investigative crime prevention, work in the community and keeping crime low. If I go into our court service, they are doing some really great stuff with digital transformation and the use of evidence, and that is enabling us to speed up the process for trials and is enabling us to bring down our court's backlog, and we hope to get back to pre-pandemic levels in this parliament. So we're trying to use innovation, we're trying to join up systems across the criminal justice system so we can see the prison population fall, crime low, bring the court backlog down, reduce the cost to the taxpayer of that overall system and deliver better outcomes overall. And that sort of system transformation is exactly ultimately what we need to do across other systems so that we can reduce the cost of the public sector in relative terms, but also improve outcomes in the years ahead.
Okay, I mean, do you accept the critique of the Auditor General in his briefing on public finances, where he says the pace and scale of reform required across the public sector needs to increase? And that's what he was saying just a couple of months ago. Do you accept that?
Well, I accept that we need to. I think, you know, over the long term, we have a fiscal sustainability risk. And I think that if we're going to mitigate that risk, the progress needs to accelerate and increase. So, yeah, I think I probably do accept it. The only reason I'm slightly sounding a bit cagey is it has been a relentless, very hard year. And so do I think everybody's working flat out to try and manage the really disruptive and severe impact of double-digit inflation on budgets? I think they are. And I mean, I have the privilege of visiting a lot of local councils very regularly. There's some incredible work going on to balance budgets, to transform and deliver better services. The same is true of our health boards. The same is true in our prison service. I think our public bodies are responding, of course, to the impact of what they are seeing in their budget in terms of real-term impacts of inflation and having to afford their own pay awards. So, of course, we need to continue to build momentum on transformation. I look at a public body like Scottish Water, where you can see a significant reduction in baseline costs and a significant improvement in outcomes. And I suppose I'm interested in focusing on the role models, talking about what good looks like and encouraging others to follow their example. I think we have some wonderful examples in Scotland we should be proud of, but I agree we need to accelerate if we're going to fulfil our full potential in the years ahead.
Yeah, and I don't think I was suggesting people are not working hard, Permanent Secretary. I think what I was suggesting was, are we prioritising? Is the strategy right? Is the leadership there? Because, again, for many of us, we remember the Christie Commission, which had a full-scale agenda for reform and early intervention and doing things differently and investing at the right time in order to have the most effective outcomes.
Yeah.
And much of that remains, you know, underutilised. And I think, again, quote the Auditor General, he's spoken variously about the implementation gap.
Yeah.
So there are these stated aims, very worthy, but actually what's going on out there on the ground is the question that we are bound to ask. We're short of time, and so I'm going to go to Craig Hoy. Craig.
Thank you, Convener. Obviously, in March 2022, the Scottish Government published its business investment framework outlining the principles for investments and decisions in the Scottish Government might take in the private sector. Just wondering, Mr. Marks, if you can bring us up to speed as to whether the Scottish Government has used the framework in practice as of yet.
So, as you say, we published it as promised at the last committee in March. We are a bit like the point we were just making around transformation, you know, building capability to ensure that we are able to manage our strategic private investments in an optimal way to secure best value for money. Colin, with thanks, has brought that unit together on strategic assets. So in terms of the capabilities that the framework talks about around bringing expert capability to bear, whether that be commercial, legal, financial, then yes, we have been doing that in the last year, bringing in experts to help provide scrutiny on things like productivity in one of our private assets, delivery plans in terms of understanding and baselining our understanding of budgets in those assets, and also helping understand and reflect on future options subject to scenarios that might occur. So the capabilities are being used and we're building them all the time. But Colin, anything you'd like to add to that?
No, what I would say, and Permanent Secretary referenced it, we have developed, we have introduced and developed a new division within the Scottish Government to lead on these matters. The principles that are inherent in that framework, you know, the need for a clear policy rationale behind any decisions, the need for a strong, comprehensive business case for investment, those are being applied every time we consider an investment in a business. And that includes the ones that we have a current relationship with, for example, Ferguson Marine Port Glasgow and the like. What I am unable to tell you about, because, and I know that you had a discussion with the Auditor General about this, is there is no case over the last 6-9 months where we have looked at an investment in a potential investment in a business, applied the framework and decided not to do it. But what I would say is that there are a range of other organisations within the public sector, not least our enterprise agencies, who are day in, day out working with businesses and will be making those judgments about the degree of private public sector support that we can offer. And those may be in different forms, including, of course, things like grants and support with training and other things like that.
So just am I correct in assuming that it hasn't yet been used in relation to a particular investment decision?
There is no investment decision that has sort of in a sort of isolated way come into the team that leads on these things, has gone through the process of the framework and has decided not to go ahead. But the principles under which we operate are being used day in, day out on every decision we make, and those would flow through into the way in which our enterprise agencies and others operate.
Obviously, the Auditor General has looked at this and made a number of recommendations as to how the framework could be strengthened. What plans have you got to respond to that, particularly in relation to strengthening the link between risk tolerance and risk appetite for investment within the Scottish Government?
Yeah, we're very happy to do that work. I would like to continue to develop this capability. I suspect some of the learning from the past would suggest that that is wise for us all and will take us forward with increased confidence. So risk tolerance, I think, is a good capability to develop there. Making sure that, from my perspective, you know, if we're going to be taking those types of decisions in the future, we've got the legal, the commercial, the financial scrutiny very robust, with the transparency of scrutiny to be confident it's optimal for the taxpayer in what are often very distressed asset situations. I think Colin met with the Audit Scotland team this week to put that plan together to do that work, and be happy to say a bit more on that.
Yes, I mean, this is an area where collaboration, and I'm sure the Auditor General would agree with me, the collaboration between Audit Scotland and the government is very strong. As Permanent Secretary said, we met earlier this week. We are continually looking for areas in which we can refine and improve that business investment framework. This is in both our interests, all our interests, that we get decisions right and we have a clear rationale for making any decisions.
Fine. You'll note from our meeting on the 19th of January that we've obviously got a significant interest in the financial interventions in Prestwick Airport and the Lochaber aluminium smelter, in addition to our ongoing inquiries in relation to Ferguson Marine. Looking to Lochaber smelter, how is the Scottish Government managing the heightened financial risk there, given the reported issues facing the Liberty Group?
Yeah. So after we talked about this last year, I really appreciate spending the day at Lochaber with the team. I do want to start by paying real tribute to the team there. I thought they were fabulous, doing an incredible job. Really appreciated the time with the engineering team, seeing the hydro operation, its scale, its impact, and the opportunity that presents. We think that Lochaber's business performance continues to be robust and resilient and is improving. It's operating profitably, and of course it has succeeded in increasing employment at Fort William, around 200 people directly employed, and a significant supply chain of hundreds of associated jobs, of course, as well. There's been no financial loss or public expenditure incurred, and we're hopeful that the development of the billet plant, the £94 million plan to obtain planning permission for construction, could still commence this year. As you know, there is significant security in terms of the land and the estate, and actually meeting the estate manager there last year. There is clearly huge potential to diversify that and to generate future revenue. In terms of the wider point with regards to GFG, you know, the team are in close contact. Obviously can't really say much more given the commercial sensitivity to all of that, but we monitor it very carefully. And Colin might say a bit more on the security aspect, but we do think Lochaber is making progress. Colin, anything more?
Yeah, I mean, I think it, as we said last year, I think it is worth always recalling that you know, there has been no call on Scottish Government guarantee, and GFG Alliance have made all their payments to bondholders that they were anticipated to make. So in that sense, you know, it's a position that we would like to see and we would want to continue. We do maintain a very close ongoing working relationship with them, particularly with the local management around the smelter. They give us good access to an understanding of how those businesses are performing, and they've been performing very well recently, largely due to external factors around power prices and the like, and we'll continue to do so. I am aware, as you were alluding to, that there have been some issues around the auditing of their accounts. Obviously, it's a matter for them, the selection of auditors, but we would hope, and I understand that they are close to selecting an auditor for the future, and we would hope to get back to that kind of relationship.
And just turning briefly to Prestwick Airport, do you have a timescale as of yet for the recovery of the investment in Prestwick Airport?
A timetable for the potential return of Prestwick Airport to the private sector?
The recovery of the investment.
I mean, there is no timetable for returning that asset to the private sector. We remain open. We have conducted OJU processes in the past. We continue to discuss that. I have to say again, in respect of Prestwick, and I was able to visit it a few weeks ago, we have a very strong management team in place, a very strong board in place, and the business itself is performing extremely well and is profitable. And I think that's a really strong position in which to try and recover that. And I think, and we've discussed this with Mr. Coffey in the past, I think the presence of a strong and robust asset at Prestwick is starting to pay dividends for the rest of Ayrshire. And we see that in things like the Mangata announcement recently.
And have you, as yet, are you in a position to make a full value for money assessment of the intervention in the airport?
I mean, we continue to assess the value for money of that investment. And I said, I think the understanding of what value for money represents is one that is a lot wider than the specifics of just the airport. But as I say, we are in a position with that asset where it is trading profitably, where I am sure that we will, in due course, be able to find people who would wish to take that back into private ownership. And I look at the success it's had with ground-based operations, the success it's had at reattracting Ryanair flights back to Marseille and elsewhere, and I think we're in a good position with that asset.
Just finally, just in relation to Ferguson Marine, obviously the vessels are still underway, the construction's underway. Are you making provision for any additional cash calls from the yard, separate to those which are to fund the construction of the vessels?
We're currently, as you know, the latest projections around the vessels were set out to the NSEC committee in September. We're currently completing our due diligence on that, and we've employed external advisors to help us on that, and we'll be coming to conclusions on that shortly. We are also in discussions with the yard about the level of investment or the plans that they have in order to continue to improve the productivity of that facility and give it a long-term sustainable future. That's a separate set of discussions, but it is one that we're actively involved in, and we will take decisions in due course on that.
I'm afraid you can't get away with mentioning Prestwick Airport, but that Willie Coffey wishes to come in with a question, so I'm going to invite Willie to put his question.
Thanks very much for allowing me in there. Convener, just on Prestwick, and my colleague Craig Hoy mentioned there, I mean, the issue did come up in discussion about how we determine value for money. For me, it's perfectly clear the impact in the Ayrshire economy, the investment by Mangata, Ryanair's developments, not only in more flights, but more maintenance jobs, Spirit's announcement this week of more recruitment. That, to me, shows the value for money investment. But is it incumbent on the government to say something about that formally? Because we do hear, and it has to be said, that some members in the Parliament say that Prestwick is a waste of money and Prestwick should have been closed. And so I think it's important, convener, that the government or its agencies say something to counter that, because the people of Ayrshire certainly don't think that. They're very proud of the airport and they want to see it grow and develop.
We share that view, and we work with partners, and particularly the local council. I mean, the aerospace and the space programme within the Ayrshire Growth Deal is a critical element of the economic development priorities of the region. And the presence of Prestwick, the ability to attract investment like the one that's being made by Mangata is absolute testament to that kind of approach, where you work with a local region, you allow regional priorities to be represented in terms of economic development priorities, and you find a way of working in partnership to support that. And I think it's a really good example of regional economic development in practice.
And just to add, Mr. Coffey, I'm happy to take away the thought of, you know, is there a sort of impartial value for money evaluation that in time could be done, as you say, to reflect on the journey the Prestwick has been on, the economic benefits, the jobs, supply chain, and what that has meant for the area. Because certainly when I visited, I thought the chair, again, very ambitious for the airport, diversifying the growth plan, good team, and like Colin, we're hopeful that it will continue to make further progress, but very happy to have a think about, is there a sort of case study evaluation on value for money that we could do in time to confirm what we think the overall sort of gross benefits are?
Okay, Thank you.
Thank you. Just a couple of quick final questions, points from me. One is going back to the GFG Alliance deal. I mean, you seem to suggest that there was no cost to the public purse and everything was fine. But I mean, if I look at the report of the Auditor General, he points out that £13.5 million of Scottish Government loans have been written off during 2019, 20, 2020, 21. So there has been some debt write-off there. And if I look at the provision for the guarantee arrangement, the provision for that is costed or valued at £114 million. Yeah. And I accept that's less than it was when you sat before us last year.
Yeah.
But it still is 300% greater than it was 2 years ago. Yeah. So there are things going on there. And you will, I'm sure, have seen the Auditor General's comments about the volatility of the situation and how things can unravel quickly.
Yeah.
So could you perhaps just give us your views on that?
Well, you know, the volatility is something that needs to be managed, and it is why the security is essential. So as you say, we need to be confident that the security covers the liability. I think that is still our financial judgment. But like you say, that relationship with GFG, with the asset team at La Carver is key. So it continues to invest, to grow and build revenue. And we can continue to assure and protect the risks to the taxpayer. So I share your point that this has a level of risk to it, which is why we have a level of security attached to the asset.
But it is a higher than normal level of risk, isn't it, when the supply chain banker of this organisation went into administration, yeah, where the Serious Fraud Office is investigating this company because of concerns about fraud and money laundering. Yep. The auditors that they had, you know, quite unusually resigned. The finance director walked. I mean, this is not just another company. This is a company which is in, you know, has been under some considerable scrutiny from parliamentary committees, this one included, because there are some real grave concerns about the business model that it operates on.
Which is totally why, going back to the conversation on the business investment framework, we need to learn from these experiences, and things like risk tolerance and financial impact assessments need to become core to that in framework going forward. But meantime, we need to manage the La Carver risks as best we can, and ultimately hope to secure and support that asset to a sustainable future and a value for money outcome. But I share your points around the risks. They are real. Colin, anything?
No, I mean, again, just to say, we are conscious of the developments, the wider issues facing GFG Alliance. We're conscious of them. We're monitoring them. We're talking to the business all the time. As the Permanent Secretary said, I think the securities that we have over the La Carver assets are sufficient to cover the liabilities that we have, but we are not blind to the risks, and we are continuing to work with the business to understand and respond to them.
But, I mean, did you have conversations with them about the fact that their accounts were not going to be audited?
I mean, we were aware of that position. As I say, it's not for us. We don't own the business at La Carver. We're not the selector of the auditor, but they did make us aware of that.
Okay. My final question is just about sponsorship arrangements, which is something which this committee has taken a very keen interest in, and we've dealt over the years with some good and bad examples of sponsorship arrangements. And there was a review carried out in 2021 which provided for, I think, 14 recommendations, and Permanent Secretary, you undertook that those 14 recommendations would be implemented. I think it was by the end of December 2022. Uh-huh. So as we meet on the 23rd of February 2023, have you met your ambition of implementing all of those 14 recommendations?
We have, and I'm really grateful to the team. A lovely letter here from the DG for Communities, who is off to become the Chief Executive of Public Health Scotland next month. So we wish Paul Johnston well in his next role, but Paul led the strategic sponsorship implementation. We have met all 14 recommendations. I think he updated the Public Audit Committee on the 6th of October with regards to that. And quite rightly, the committee said, well, that's not the end of the journey, is it? You know, that is the end of the beginning, if you like. So we've done the review. We think we've got the recommendations in place. But now it is about establishing best practice. And if perhaps, you know, there's a point that comes out of the whole conversation today. It is about building capability. Good chairs, good non-execs, good chief execs, challenging, stripping out optimism, you know, managing risk, developing good strategies, good plans, transforming to reduce cost and improve outcomes. It's all about building capability. And that is what we're trying to do in the Scottish Government. It's what I'm trying to coach my sponsor teams to do. And it's what we want our public bodies to all be doing as well. And as you say, there will be a few for which there is some bumpy roads ahead, but there are also some wonderful role models doing some incredible things. And we will be using the learning and the experience of the review to continue to make further progress.
Well, on that positive note, can I draw this morning's evidence session to a close? Can I thank our witnesses, Permanent Secretary Colin Cook, Jackie McAllister and Alison Cumming for your input. There are some areas we didn't quite get to because of the time, but we might follow those areas up in writing to you if that's okay. And I think you've undertaken to look at some of the issues we've raised as well in the session and come back to us. So can I thank you very much for your time and your contribution. And I'm now going to call the public part of this morning's committee meeting to a close.